tiny beginning, but a very important one. And thank you for being here. For those of you who are already active, thank you. And for those who are just exploring or beginning, thank you for engaging in this conversation. Having been involved in the food freedom movement for years now, I've seen aggression against our producers actively. We've seen guns on the farms, armed raids, producers and drivers being pulled over on the street, prosecution, and endless taxpayer dollars being used against our producers who are producing something for our bodies. The basic of all rights, our right to peacefully choose and acquire food, is threatened. Those of us involved in food freedom have seen the legislatures fail, we've seen the courts fail, and we've seen our own government repeatedly attack us and deprive us of the very food that we need to be well. And in some very real cases, the food that people need to live. When I began thinking about non-compliance as a way to approach this, as a means to restore our freedom, I studied it a lot. I took notebooks from the library, I read up on Gandhi, read up on Martin Luther King, and the freedom riders of the 60s. I became a student, and it was incredibly empowering to learn this history of peaceful non-compliance. And I encourage each of you to do exactly the same. And we know, you know, from our elementary school time or high school, we know that our culture has a long, glorious, and successful history of peaceful non-compliance, something we can all call to mind. And one of the principles we're going to be looking at today, Gandhi so aptly puts it, nonviolence is the greatest force at the disposal of mankind.
Absolutely.
It is mightier than the mightiest weapon of destruction devised by the ingenuity of man. And that's really the principle that we're centering on. When there are injustices in the world and initiation of violence, it is the opportunity of a lifetime to participate in peaceful non-compliance to further the life and the liberty of our fellow human beings. Like I said, we live with this cultural consciousness of that peaceful non-compliance. And we're all empowered when we consider the proud history that we come from and how broadly these tactics are used. I want to discuss two forms of peaceful non-compliance, two different types. The first one is non-compliance with laws in order to protect people's lives and liberty in immediate situations. And the second one is the non-compliance in order to actively change or abolish laws. And both of these reasons for non-compliance exist in the food freedom movement. So non-compliance in order to protect people's lives and liberty. Not everybody who engages in peaceful non-compliance does so to change laws. Some people have a very strong moral obligation to do so because they see people's lives or liberty threatened in an immediate situation. Can anybody think of an example of something I might be talking about? Yes.
Anything?
Yeah.
Right. My wife and I make phone calls for our house. For ourselves. It's not a registered kitchen, it's just my kitchen.
Right.
A friend of mine said that the guy needs, I think it's a bone problem. Your bone problem, so it went to the third party, canning line. 2 weeks after he got my first can of problem, he called, sent me an email with a number. I called him, he said, how can I get one of this stuff? I think I sold him 14 gallons of this stuff so far the last 6 months.
It's saving his life.
It's been the catalyst.
Yeah.
Just that added little bit of real food that he's now gaining weight. Gaining strength. My wife said he paid 18 whole golf set 4 weeks ago. Here's a recovering cancer survivor.
Jonas is bringing up an example of how people are using non-compliance, farmers especially right now, in order to save people's lives. And examples from history also include people helping with the Underground Railroad, helping free slaves, and those who hid Jews during the Nazi occupation of Europe. And I'm sure many of you can think of multiple examples of how civil disobedience and peaceful non-compliance is used in situations to immediately save somebody's life. And in the case of farmers, like Jonas, like you just mentioned, there are farmers who are every day breaking laws and breaking regulations. in order to provide people the food they need to live and grow. And if we do not act in solidarity with them now, we will be facing far worse scenarios in the future. When we reflect on instances of peaceful nonviolence in history, we can identify with those who we consider heroes. And then we can use these individuals to draw inspiration from. Can anybody think of examples in recent history of peaceful non-compliers who inspire you? Anyone?
Vernon Hirschberger, James Stewart.
Anyone else?
Mark Knoll.
And all three of those men who you just named are all farmers who have been consistently engaging in peaceful non-compliance in order to feed their communities. Some of the examples I like are the Quakers. It's a group, but they were known to the slaves as people who they could approach and would help the slaves with any kind of estate or any kind of sanctuary that they needed. The Underground Railroad, another recent example. And by recent, I mean the past 500 years.
Corrie Ten Boom.
Pardon?
Corrie Ten Boom.
Okay, I don't know that name.
That's the Danish family that was hiding Jewish families in their house until they finally were sent to the concentration camps themselves.
Wow. And yes, exactly. All those hundreds of thousands of millions of unnamed people who helped the Jews escape, who helped slaves escape.
How about Martin Luther?
And one in particular for me, my hero is Irina Sendler. Has anyone heard of Irina Sendler? She was a young woman in German-occupied Poland who successfully led a movement of over 25 people. And they all went into the concentration camps and helped babies and small children escape from the concentration camps in Warsaw. She knew from the beginning that in doing so, she risked her own life. But she did it anyway. And in 1943, she was arrested by the Gestapo, severely tortured, and sentenced to death. Her colleagues saved her by bribing the guards on her way to execution. And she was listed on public bulletin boards as having been executed. But for the remainder of the war, she stayed in hiding and continued to help Jewish children escape. She saved over 2,500 Jewish babies and children. And many years later, in a letter to the Polish parliament, she said, "Every child saved with my help is the justification of my existence on this earth and not a title." Imagine for a moment what it must have taken to be among those risking or sacrificing their lives, their safety, their fortunes, time, energy, and effort in order to immediately secure the lives and liberty of others. Whether you embrace this as a one-time deal or an ongoing work, this opportunity and this very power is yours as well, for every single one of us. Now, the second kind of noncompliance is really noncompliance to change a law. And this looks a little bit different than the first version. As Gandhi says, noncooperation is an attempt to awaken the masses to a sense of their dignity and power. This can only be done by enabling them to realize that they need not fear brute force if they would but know the soul within. The only way to maintain our rights is to stand up for them when our rights are violated or threatened with force. Choosing to engage in deliberate noncompliance is a personal decision for each of us, and how to apply it to the context in our own lives. Sometimes we need to comply with certain laws in order to bring the focus to others, like we're doing tomorrow. And it's important to respect individual rights while engaging in noncompliance to change laws. Can anybody think of any recent examples of peaceful noncompliance to change existing laws, maybe the past 100 years? Okay, so that would be included in the past 200, 300 years. Right. So we have all of that, right? We have Gandhi leading the Salt March in India. We've got Martin Luther King Jr. here, the Civil Rights Movement, and all the people who did
know the story of George Washington Carver?
Well, how about this? How about the Freedom Riders of the 60s? Does anybody know their story?
No.
All right. The Freedom Riders of the 60s, they did something incredibly spectacular. They used their own bodies to challenge the Jim Crow laws. And young people gathered from all over the country to participate in this. They organized, they took training courses, they took weeks off work, they spent their own money, they spent their own time and their own energy. And for them, it was a real honor to take a beating to be a Freedom Rider. And that is also what made it as effective as it was. So, do you all get the significance of this? People lined up and volunteered for the opportunity to go get arrested, to go get beat up, in order to change a law that they saw was completely unjust. But pause for a moment just to consider what it must have been like for the individuals in any of the circumstances we have discussed. Why did they do it? And were they afraid? What did they hope to gain from it? What were they risking? Were they concerned for job, income, or property loss? Were they worried about repercussions for their families? And then finally, what would you do? For anyone who is unsure where they are with wanting to participate in peaceful noncompliance, I encourage you to study the teachings of history and other peaceful noncompliers to simultaneously gain inspiration and realize our own potential to live this aim. People will go to different lengths. Some of you here today will decide you're better off in support capacity to those wanting to be the most radical. Some will not be able to sleep or sit still unless they are able to actively go as far as they can to prep the imbalance. And others will quietly not comply with unjust laws and regulations. And others will help where they see people threatened, like those who killed the Jews or those who helped slaves escape. Every role serves a purpose. And every role is important. Whichever yours is, embrace it. The two questions we all need to ask ourselves is, at what point will I be engaged? And how far am I willing to go? And draw the boundary for what you're willing to comply with. Decide when you'll make the effort. Take the days off. Spend the money. Make the sacrifice. Be there to peacefully not comply by the laws and regulations. For everyone, it's different. Now I'm going to introduce Max Kane, who's going to talk a little bit more about how to stand up for your rights and how to stand up for your freedoms. And Max does just that in his own state.